Welcome to It's Your Date with Destiny with Apostle Vivian and Pastor Gemma Duncan of Divine Destiny Worship Center in Diego Martin. For the next 30 minutes, join us as we take you on a journey of maximizing your potential and realizing your goals through Jesus Christ.
Why is it when you need a miracle, it doesn't happen, but when you least expect it, it happens?
You are married. You have challenges in your relationship, but your spouse is unwilling to accede to any counseling. Is divorce an option?
How does a parent handle a promiscuous child?
What are considered the do's and don'ts of a born-again couple who is not yet married?
There are always more questions than answers. So here is Apostle Gemma.
Grace and peace to you. Welcome to us, Pastor Gemma. And once again, I thank you for taking the time to be with me this afternoon. In the event that you're a first-time viewer, my name is Gemma Duncan, and my husband, Apostle Vivian Duncan, and myself are the pastors of Divine Destiny Worship Center. Today, and for the next 3 weeks, I want to share some excerpts of a sermon ministered by Apostle Donnell Duncan, our eldest son, on the anniversary of the consecration of our children. Donnell and his wife Angel were consecrated as apostles. Dion and his wife Leah were also consecrated as apostles. And our daughter Jade Duncan was ordained as a prophet. And we gathered in Bethel House of Worship. That's the ministry led by our second son Dion and his wife Leah to celebrate the first anniversary. And Donnell shared a powerful message that I felt needed to be spread abroad. And he answered some questions that I have had for years, and I'm sure many of you would have had. Why aren't we seeing more of the children of pastors and believers who serve well in the Church of Jesus Christ? Why aren't we seeing them following in our footsteps? Where are they? Ask yourself, over the years, you've known many pastors. Where are their children? I know that you can serve God other than being in the pulpit, but why aren't they visible? Why isn't there a flow down of the anointing on one of them, somebody to carry on the legacy, the spiritual legacy of the family? The question also that begs to be answered is, why aren't we seeing that same level of anointing on people in the church who serve under a particular leader? Pastor is powerful. Signs and wonders, the miraculous. The prophetic. Very influential, very impacting. And yet you're not seeing the people rising up in that level. And Donnell answered these questions. Another question he answered was, what happened to the anointing on Elijah? Because it was handed over to Elisha, but Elisha died with the anointing, to the point that a young man got raised from the dead when his corpse was thrown into Elisha's grave. And amazingly, when you view the series, you will realize that the person who really inherited Elijah's anointing was John the Baptist. But you will hear more about it. So we have a number of questions we have, and we're going to get some answers. Elijah passed on to Elisha. Elisha's servant Gehazi didn't get it. Aaron's son didn't get his anointing. Eli's son didn't get his anointing. Samuel's son didn't get his anointing. Judas followed Jesus and didn't get his anointing. And so I want you to really call up somebody you have to follow through. There are three sessions. What happened to the anointing? And this afternoon we're going to view what happened to the anointing, part two.
So the anointing that was on Elijah was passed on to Elisha. Then Elijah took it to his grave. It took about 900 years before God raised up John the Baptist to walk in that anointing again. Thank God it didn't leave permanently. It took 900 years though, before another person walked in the same anointing. It took decades before there was another prophet, but it took 900 years before somebody walked in that anointing. There were prophets, but nobody was like Elijah until John the Baptist. It's one of the reasons why Jesus called John the Baptist the greatest prophet ever. Because that was that Elijah anointing. Ain't nobody walking that kind of anointing. Like, nobody will prophesy like Elijah. Like, there were prophets. I mean, there were great prophets, but like, anybody touching Elijah until John the Baptist. That's why even Jesus was like, John the Baptist special. He's no ordinary prophet. That's the greatest he ever met. Why? That was Elijah's anointing. Why did it take 900 years for the anointing that was on the life of Elijah, that was passed on to Elisha, to finally benefit the people of Israel again? What happened to the anointing? Look at your neighbor and ask, what happened to the anointing? It's funny, I was sitting down thinking, what are we going to preach, boy? And the Lord said, what happened to the anointing? What happened? 900 years before another person walked in that anointing. That's why I love sitting down and listening to church. Because in church, we thought it was a good thing that the bones of Elisha heal a man. That's a good thing. We're like, boy, them bones had the anointing on it, boy. And then God was like, son, why was the anointing the greatest prophetic anointing ever in a grave? Yeah. What was it doing there? Who was it benefiting? What was the point? And we celebrate the fact that the anointing was in his bones, instead of on the earth benefiting the people of Israel. It took 900 years before they benefited from that anointing again. Because Gehazi dropped the battle. Gehazi dropped the battle. You ever run a relay and drop the battle? I've dropped the battle before. Listen, I'm a grown man and I still remember that race. I was in the National Stadium in Trinidad. My. And it was a smaller relays for high schools. And if you win, it's smaller, you're drinking. And I was the third leg. And that fella came and I was like, oh gosh, we're going to get him. And the guy in last leg was our fastest runner. And that man came with our baton. And you know you have your little zone. And I was trying to be Atto. Kick off a little early, you know, get a little momentum. Instead of old school, like we're accustomed, wait for the battle. Don't be a hero now, oh gosh. You're going to save a little second, you're not that fast. You can just wait, get the battle, secure it, then run hard, you know. But no, I try to be a little Atto. And I was like, take off hard. And run right out the zone. I think the baton, I was just like, the guy in last leg was like, oh gosh. Gehazi dropped the baton. Tell your neighbor, Gehazi dropped the baton. 2 Kings chapter 5 verse 1 in the Amplified. 2 Kings chapter 5 verse 1 in the Amplified. Let's read this again after 3, 2, 3. Now Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Aram, Syria, was considered a great man by his king and was highly respected because through Naaman, the Lord had given victory to Aram, Syria. He was also a man of courage, but he was a leper. Verse 8 to 10, let's read it. Now when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent word to the king asking, why have you torn your clothes? Just let Naaman come to me, and he shall know that there is a true prophet in Israel. So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and stopped at the entrance of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him saying, go and wash in the Jordan 7 times and your flesh will be restored to you. And you will be clean. Verse 14 to 16 now. Let's read it together. So he went down and plunged himself into the Jordan 7 times, just as the man of God had said. Then Naaman returned to the man of God, he and all the people in his group, and stood before him. He said, behold, I know that there is no God in all the earth except in Israel. So now accept a blessing and gift from your servant. But Elisha said, as the Lord lives, before whom I stand, I will accept nothing. He urged them to take it, but Elisha refused. It was customary all throughout the Old Testament. You receive a word, a healing, a miracle. You receive any benefit from the anointing on a prophet. You hand a man a little something. You hand a woman a little something. The scripture call it a blessing. That's what Naaman was like. Let me bless you. Now. We still say that these days. Let me bless you. Naaman was like, let me hold this. And Elisha was, nah, I'm good. And he insisted, oh gosh. Because this man had leprosy. Leprosy in those days was like AIDS. Remember the AIDS pandemic? When AIDS was ravaging the earth. People used to not want to touch somebody with AIDS. You're not going to get AIDS if you touch the person. But we were like, no, you can't touch them. They come in the room. Everybody ran out the room and thing. That's what it was like. That's what leprosy was. A man had leprosy. He had leprosy. Nobody wanted to get close to them. That was the worst disease in that generation. They just made it like, oh gosh, you're nothing. Get away from us. And he got healed. And all he wanted was to bless the man who did something that he never thought could happen. Hold this, Elisha. Hold that. Put it in your pocket. A Holy Ghost handshake. Let me shake your hand. I'm going to tell something inside it. He's like, no, I don't want this. I don't want this. That's when the story gets interesting. Let's go to verses 19 to 27. Let's read it. Elisha said to him, go in peace. So Naaman departed and was a good distance away from him when Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, the man of God, said, my master has spared this Naaman, the Aramean Syrian, by not accepting from him what he brought. As the Lord lives, I will run after him and get something from him. So Gehazi pursued Naaman. When Naaman saw someone running after him, he got down from the chariot to meet him and said, it's all well. And he said, all is well. My master sent me to say, just now two young men of the sons of the prophets have come to me from the hill country of Ephraim. Please give me a talent of silver and two changes of clothes. Naaman said, please take two talents. And he urged him to accept and tied up two talents of silver in two bags with two changes of clothes and gave them to two of his servants. And they carried them in front of Gehazi. When he came to the hill, he took them from their hand and put them in the house for safekeeping. And he sent the men away, and they left. Then he went in and stood before his master, Elisha. Elisha asked him, where have you been, Gehazi? Elisha walks in a double portion of Elijah's anointing. Elijah and Elisha could be sitting down over here and they could hear what you're talking about in your bedroom, miles away. These were no ordinary prophets. You see what I'm saying? They're in your conversation talking about, okay, king, this is exactly what they're talking about. And Gehazi knew that. He knew it. Where have you been, Gehazi? And when he said that, the Lord reminded me of when the Lord said, Adam, where are you? Like, he don't know where Adam is. That's a rhetorical question. That's a rhetorical question. You know what I'm saying? Adam, where are you? Gehazi, where have you been? Rhetorical question. He said, your servant went nowhere.
Oh, Lord.
Elisha said to him, did my heart not go with you when the man turned from his chariot to meet you? The man just sitting in his chair and he's seeing everything that's happening from his chair, relaxing himself. He's like, did my heart not go with you when the man turned from his chariot to meet you, giving him specific details? Not being general. The man turned from his chariot to meet you. Is it a proper time to accept money and clothing and olive orchards and vineyards and sheep and oxen and male and female servants? He's being very specific. It's like, is this really a good time for that? Is it proper? Therefore, the leprosy of Naaman shall cling to you and to your descendants forever. I don't think we remember the part of and to your descendants forever. This wasn't just Gehazi. Gehazi got a curse that went upon him and anybody who came from Gehazi forever. Remember, this is a double portion of Elijah's anointing. If he says forever, he mean forever, ever. This ain't no joke, prophet. So Gehazi departed from his presence, a leper as white as snow. You go two chapters and you see Gehazi show up again. But then if you look in the Amplified, they said that next appearance of Gehazi actually occurred before this. So even though it showed up two chapters later, it really had happened before. This was the end of Gehazi. You never heard of him again. That was it. Hold that leprosy. Go your way. Somebody say Gehazi dropped the battle. He served the man who was walking with the double portion of Elijah's anointing. He was the closest person to Elisha. Elisha was mentoring him. Elisha would pray over him, Lord, open his eyes so he can see in the spirit. He had the privilege to hold the man's staff. He was the guy. He was the guy. There was nobody else as close to him. Gehazi was right there. That was his. He was supposed to be that guy. Gehazi served Elisha and should have been next in line to receive the anointing of Elijah. But his lack of character cost him his spiritual inheritance. He served. I was taught, as long as you serve, you're supposed to get the anointing. So I want to give me the bag quick. Let me carry the pastor bag. Let me hold your Bible. Let me bring up your tablet. Because I thought I just had to serve. Because Gehazi served. He's supposed to get the double portion or the double portion. The man deserves it. After all this work that man put in, he did the work. And how many times have I sat down and listened to people teach? Serve. If you serve, you're going to get the anointed. If you walk in that service, if you show up and you wash the man's car, you vacuum that church, you clean them toilets, you go walk in that anointing. That's what I thought. So I was like, boy, I'm going to put on my t-shirt and my short pants and my flip-flops. And I come out here and serve because I want that anointing. Gehazi served. He served. But he didn't have no character. The character cost him his spiritual inheritance. He did the work, but he didn't have the character. What if he received a double portion of the double portion of Elijah's anointing? He would have been the greatest prophet in history. There would have never been a prophet as great as Gehazi. That we would have been preaching messages on Gehazi. What a prophet. In an alternate story with an alternate ending, Gehazi. I mean, he wouldn't be parting water. He would be like walking on the water. Like, we need to part it. I can walk on it. Don't study it. I have a bridge right there in the spirit. He could have done stuff you never thought was possible after what Elijah did and then Elisha did. He didn't have no character. What worked for Elisha to inherit Elijah's anointing didn't work for Gehazi. Because Elisha poured water in the hands of Elijah, Elisha got the anointing. Gehazi poured water in the hands of Elisha, and Elisha gave him nothing. Maybe he was a good servant, but he lacked the character to carry that level of anointing. All along, we didn't realize the reason why Gehazi didn't get it and the reason why Elisha got it wasn't just that he poured water on the hands of Elisha. Elijah, he had the character. He had the character. Because you think you can mimic what somebody else does and think you're going to get that anointing. So I go and make a church and I'm like, oh gosh, all I need to do is be one of the armor bearers. And boy, when it's my turn to preach, it's fire. Why? Because I was an armor bearer. Because that's what I taught. So people come and they serve and then they start a church. Because the assumption is, if I serve in that church under that man, and I start a church, you know, I walk in that anointing. Because I was taught service equal anointing. That's what I was taught. Just show up and work hard. And people genuinely come in churches and they do serve. And they walk out thinking, well, where is my anointing? They didn't realize that that ain't it. That ain't it. It took 900 years for the Lord to find someone else who had the character for Elijah's anointing. It took John the Baptist to pick up the battle that Gehazi dropped centuries later. Nobody else could have walked in that anointing until John the Baptist. He was just like Elijah. God was like, aha, you can walk in that anointing. He was just like him. But the signs were there. Tell your neighbor the signs were there. You ever been in a bad relationship and then you look back and you're like, boy, the signs were there, yes? All along, I should have known this. You look back and you can reminisce on all the stuff you missed. I mean, everybody knows. You've never been surprised by a bad relationship. Anybody been in a bad relationship and be like, what? I didn't know this was going to be bad. You look back and you always remember. I knew it. There's always signs. There's always something. And all the signs get clear. When the situation messes up real bad, then you look back and you be like, boy, that happened and that happened and that happened. I should have paid attention, yes? I should have dumped that person 20 years ago. So tell you the thing, the signs were there. Gehazi didn't surprise Elisha that day. Gehazi already had been showing something wasn't right with this fella. 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 18 to 35 in the Amplified. Let's read that together after 3. 2, 3. When the child was grown, the day came that he went out to his father, to the reapers. But he said to his father, my head, my head. The man said to his servant, carry him to his mother. When he had carried and brought him to his mother, he sat on her lap until noon. And then he died. She went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God and shut the door of the small upper room behind him and left. Then she called to her husband and said, please, send me one of the servants and one of the donkeys so that I may run to the man of God and return. He said, why are you going to him today? It is neither the new moon nor the Sabbath. And she said, it will be all right. And the Lord was like, when she said it will be all right, it's kind of like me saying, I'm good. I'm good. As in, I actually read in the Amplified and it says, she didn't tell him what happened. The Amplified said, it hints that she didn't say a word. She didn't even know what, was going on. She didn't tell nobody. She was like, nah, it's cool. Everything's cool. Everything's cool. I'm going to find a man of God. But this makes it, why are you, we're good. It will be all right. Let's keep reading. Then she saddled the donkey and said to her servant, drive the animal fast. Do not slow down the pace for me unless I tell you. So she set out and came to the man of God at Mount Carmel. When the man of God saw her at a distance, he said to Gehazi's servant, look, there is a Shunammite woman. Please run now to meet her and ask her, is it well with you? Is it well with your husband? Is it well with the child? And she answered, it is well. I'm good. She's like, I'm straight. I'm good. All is well. I'm good. How you doing? I'm good. Blessed, highly favored. The Lord sits on the throne. He looks high. He looks low. When she came to the mountain, to the man of God, she took hold of his feet. Gehazi approached to push her away. But the man of God said, let her alone, for her soul is desperate and troubled within her. And the Lord has hidden the reason from me and has not told me. Then she said, did I ask for a son from my Lord? Did I not say, do not give me false hope? Then he said to Gehazi, like, gird up your loins, prepare now, and take my staff in your hand and go to the woman's house. I underline, take my staff in your hand. The same way Elisha took the mantle of Elijah and was able to do the same miracle Elijah did, he was like, well, this is my servant. Take my staff and do the same thing that I could do. Just like I took the mantle of Elijah and did the same thing Elijah. That's what servants could do. Walk in the anointing, son. Operate in the anointing. Go and do what I would do. Hold the staff. Go to the woman's house. If you meet any man along the way, do not greet him. And if a man greets you, do not stop to answer him. And lay my staff on the face of the boy as soon as you reach the house. The mother of the child said, as the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you. So Elisha arose and followed her. Gehazi went on ahead of them and laid the staff on the boy's face. But there was no sound or response from the boy. Nothing happened. It's similar to Elisha taking the mantle of Elijah and hitting the water. And the only thing that happened is the mantle get wet. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. And Elisha won't waste time giving the man the staff if he knew it wasn't going to work. So the assumption was it should work. Here's a man walking in the double portion of Elijah. He knows it's supposed to work. If I give you my staff, you're my servant, you serve me, you're supposed to be able to do this miracle. Go and knock out a miracle for me, please. So he turned back to meet Elisha and told him, the boy has not awakened or revived. When Elisha came into the house, the child was dead and lying on his bed. So he went in, shut the door behind the two of them, and prayed to the Lord. Then he went up and lay on the child and put his mouth on his mouth, his eyes on his eyes, and his hands on his hands. And he stretched himself out on him and held him. The boy's skin became warm. Then he returned and walked in the house once back and forth and went up again and stretched himself out on him. And the boy sneezed 7 times and he opened his eyes. So we know the anointing was still on Elisha to raise the dead. So it's not that, so none was wrong with Elisha. And the staff is an inanimate object. So nothing wrong with the staff. The staff is the staff. So the only thing that's missing here is we have an anointing that we know still. Right. We have a staff that's still a staff. Right. And we have Gehazi. And he's the only piece of it that we're wondering. Okay, if this didn't work, it's not Elisha. It's not the staff. What's up with this guy? All along, the signs were there that Gehazi was not the right candidate to receive the anointing that was on Elisha. Even though, if I was looking on from the outside, after watching the Elijah-Elisha situation, I would have assumed there would have been an Elisha-Gehazi story, the same story. Because he's doing this, the actions seem the same. It's comparable. Red flags. Look at your name and say red flags. When the Shunammite woman initially sensed the anointing on Elisha, she also sensed the lack of it on Gehazi. Hence, she didn't deal with him. The Shunammite woman had the spirit of discernment. She said, I sense that there is a non-anointing on Elisha. She had the spirit. She could tell something special with Elisha. She told her husband, I sense. So in the spirit, she had the ability to tell there is an anointing on Elisha. But what we realize also is she had the ability to tell there is not an anointing on Gehazi. Because the same way she could sense where the anointing was, she could sense where the anointing was not.
Remember what Jesus said. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me.